So it's finally the day. We are going from gigabit fiber internet to 10 gigabit internet on our own dedicated wavelength. So behind this door is my friends, Danny and Chad from ITEL, who are gonna be helping me with this little upgrade, by the end of which we will have literally 10 times the bandwidth that we have currently to the main Harbor Exchange in Vancouver. With GlassWire, you can instantly see your current and past network activity, detect malware, and block badly behaving apps on your PC or Android device. Use offer code Linus and get 25% off at the link below. Okay, so step one, collect underpants. Step two, we need to look at these two electrical rooms. This one is building A, is that correct?
Yes.
And then we also need to take a look inside the electrical room of building F, because my understanding is that maybe you could help find it for me. The main fiber connection to TELUS is coming into this building, is that right?
Yeah.
So here we found it. This is the TELUS fiber optic cable that is coming in from the street. This is a beefy boy, but you can actually see there's a reason for that. Here we are. So that right there is all of the fiber strands that are protected, not just by this orange and blue sheathing, but then also by this thick black sheathing around the outside. So we can tell three pairs. So each one of these is a send and receive pair, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you can only have three fiber optic connections running into this entire complex of business units. So one of the pairs here has actually been, there we go, run into this guy. So this is a CWDM, and this takes a single 10 gigabit wavelength, and then it is splitting it out into 10 1 gigabit connections. So our old connection actually runs off of this puppy right here, and then we just had two entire pairs. That would be called dark fiber, is that correct? We're just not doing anything at all. So now, aha, you can see here, Linus Media Group gets its own. So we're running off of 3 and 4 that are dedicated just to us now. We are gonna take, there we go, this right here, and we're gonna plug in the one that's sitting up on the top, and instead of going into our gigabit gear, it's now gonna go into our 10 gig gear. Now, you guys said this was some kind of switch. What was the brand of it?
Sienna.
So what this Sienna switch does is it allows ITEL to constantly monitor the speed that we're getting, make sure that nothing's going down, there's no hiccups or anything like that. And then it's basically just going to pass through over to building F, where it will then carry over to our server room. So to ISP or data center guys who work with this kind of stuff all the time, I might as well be making a video about a screwdriver, I suppose. But for those of you who don't, I want to take this opportunity because we're not ready to cut over to this yet. We've got to make sure that the transceiver on the other end in our server room matches this one before we can go ahead and just pop the fibers in. I wanted to show you guys exactly what kind of gear we're looking at. So this is a long haul 10 gigabit transceiver. So our fibers go in here, and then they are converted to copper signals that your computer or your router or your switch in this case can understand. And there's all kinds of different types of these things. Everything from 10 kilometer long range to 40 kilometer long range to short range ones to ones that are designed to carry a single wavelength to ones that are designed to carry multiple wavelengths. And the main difference for this one is that it's going to be laser rather than LED, which is what you'd normally use for just like one of the cheapo ones you get off eBay, just, you know, running from your server room to your, you know, editing room or whatever else. And the strength of the signal. So it's super bright because it's designed to go over very long distances. You wanna make sure they're not mismatched, because even if you have two long range ones, if you've got a very long range one and it's too bright for the distance of the cable, you can actually get attenuation. So it's all dark magic to me, but pretty freaking cool. Okay, so now we're headed over to the electrical room of our building, where honestly nothing really happens other than that it's just like spliced together basically, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So this is a good opportunity though to explain the difference between having your own dedicated wavelength and having your own dedicated fiber run. So even though that fiber that's over in building A is gonna go all the way out to the road and to TELUS's nearest, what would that be called?
A splice point.
It's going to be combined with other pairs over there, and it's only that light wavelength that is actually dedicated to us along that path. And that path is dynamic. Like if someone's, you know, digging a post and cut something or whatever, it's gonna get automatically routed around. But it's still pretty much a direct path, tens of kilometers away to Harbor Center. And what we're expecting to see is somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 gigabit per second and about 1 millisecond of latency. So you guys actually had one of your techs. Did I overhear someone ran a benchmark? And what are we looking at from your switch?
9.8 gigabit.
9.8 gig. Well, where's my other 0.2? You bastards.
I can explain where it is.
Yeah, can you? Can you? Okay, all right. You want to explain it?
Not on camera.
You don't want to explain it on camera. All right. Something about TCP testing. No. This is the thing about internet service providers. You know, there's always an excuse.
There's overhead.
Okay, so now we're over in our building. So building A was the first one of this complex. So that's where everything comes in from the street. That makes sense. So we've got one black cable, here we go, that comes all the way up here and then into, what would this be, like a splicer box? Like what would you call this? Sure. I'm calling it a splicer box, but he's a splicing cabinet, maybe it's the technical term, I don't know, it doesn't matter. Anyway, so you can see here, all our fiber strands are separated here, and this would normally be closed for protection. And then it's going right there. We're the only ones in this building with fiber internet, obviously. And then our yellow one goes into this orange sheath, and then all the way back down here to unit 102. So 101, 102, 103, and 104 are all Linus Media Group, but that's where our server room is. So now we're gonna go over there. So now we're in our server room where that orange sheath that we saw in the other building comes in from the top and then it comes in the back of our cabinet and plugs into this guy, just a patch panel. Okay, cool. So then we're actually gonna continue to use this exactly the same way we used to, is that right? Now, the one extra piece of equipment that we had before that we will no longer need actually is this MRV right here, which was essentially a media converter. So we were taking this fiber out of our fiber patch panel and then we reconfigured this guy so that we could run this copper connection into our PFSense router, which is actually over on the back of our rack. So this just goes away and I get a U back. Yes, good, fantastic. So then Danny, basically what you need to check is if these are long haul transceivers or short range ones, is that right?
Not these. These are 1 gig transceivers. We need to check your new transceiver to make sure it's 10 gig.
My new transceiver, which one's that?
In your PFSense, 10 gig.
Yeah, it's just an SFP plus port. So there's no transceiver.
Okay, then we'll give you a transceiver.
Yay! Okay, so I've got up the menu and I think I know which ones they are. I think it's IGB 0 or 1. I don't know which though. So it's gonna be a little bit of trial and error here. So next step then is message everyone and tell them the internet's going down. Internet going down, warning. And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So ITEL tells me normally this is a two-person operation, so you can just like both move them at the same time, but we wanted to film it, and we only had one camera person available, so I guess everyone gets to sit inside in the dark of no internet. They're both doing things. Look, Danny's plugging in the other one. So there we go. So what have you moved over?
All I did was plug the cable in, and he's plugging in.
Okay. So that old 1 gig hardware is technically all still there.
The 1 gig circuit's still up in parallel. We know it works, then we tear it down.
Then we tear it down. Yeah. Got it.
So now...
theoretically, over on the other end, we're 10 gig. Okay. So theoretically, I should see like some kind of LED indicator on that if it's working, I guess, right? Nothing so far. So there's 6 RJ45s and 2 SFP Plus.
Right, so the SFP Plus are not showing up in this list.
Okay. So worst case scenario, there is a PCI Express expansion slot on this thing. And we definitely have SFP Plus cards.
That was definitely showing IXL 2 and 3 before, though, I'm sure.
Did they just die?
I would hope not.
What is this?
It doesn't actually say what it's trying to find.
ARP request, cannot find matching address. What is that even? 5, reboot the system. Yeah, let's reboot normally. So while it was booting up, IX 2 and 3 showed as all the devices were initializing. So they exist, they're just not showing up in the list. I think the problem might be that for LAN interface, I entered IXL0 instead of IXL0.1. Shouldn't matter? Well, it's still freaking out about that 10.20.0.74 nonsense. I'm rebooting. On the bright side, we have a link now. That's good, thank you, Danny. Thanks, Danny. No, Pello, there's no update. Holy crap. I think it actually kept the configuration from last time. Look at this. WAN is IXL3, it has an IP. Okay, so WAN interface. You guys wanna have a look at this? It appears to be up. Okay, so we're not sure exactly what happened, but the latest update is that ITEL's guys are seeing our MAC address. What is that? Anthony! Why did you have those, why were those aggregated?
I don't know.
Oh, and our internet's up. got lag killed today. So, let the record show, I actually did know what I was doing. I just didn't know that someone had tampered with my sort of knew what I was doing. Like I could have checked this before they got here. What was happening was two of our 8 interfaces just weren't showing up in this list because there was a link aggregation group set up that was showing up, but we didn't recognize because we were looking for IXL3. So everything that I thought was supposed to happen, with everyone arguing with me, where I was like, no, no, blah, 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 it'll show up, and all this stuff, and blah, 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 blah. The only thing I did wrong was I bunged up plugging in the fiber so that it wasn't lighting up. Since then, it's been, I mean, there's an element of user error. You know what, I'm sure all the network admins in there, the ones that aren't telling us that pfSense is totally unsuitable for 10 gig, are telling me why I'm wrong. But anyway, the point is, you know what? Bam, it's working. All right, so what we want to do now is ping our gateway and see if we're getting the advertised 1 millisecond ping times. So you're at 50% here, Danny, 50%.
Part of that's response from your router.
Oh yeah, oh, you're blaming my router now. Oh, I see how it's gonna be. So we can actually see here whether we should blame my router or not. It looks like our send time is 0.3 milliseconds. And then our round trip time is right in the neighborhood of 2 milliseconds there. So we can see that by refreshing it here. It's really consistent. Dang. So it's all working, we've got internet, but one of the coolest things about our sub 2 millisecond round trip time to Harbor Center is that we could basically have direct layer 2 access to anything else that's in there. So if we wanted to connect directly to a CDN, or if we wanted to put our own servers in there, I mean, I guess that's probably expensive, but theoretically we could do it, right? We just have a 10 gigabit pipe to Harbor Center that happens to be bringing us internet. Now, the way you explain it to me, we basically have 5.5 gigabit to the broader internet, but 10 gigabit to anything that's at Vanix. Is that right?
Or Harbor Center.
It's
your wavelength to there.
Okay.
You have 5 gigs of internet transit.
5 gigs of internet, 5.5.
6.
We'll 6 it. With overhead?
Sure.
So all that's left now is to run a speed test, but we have a slight problem. We're gonna press go and we're gonna discover that speed test relies on the server at the other end having the amount of bandwidth that you are testing for. So we just maxed out someone's gigabit server somewhere, because the reality of it is, if anyone had a multi-$1,000 a month internet connection, a 10 gig connection, they'd be using it for something. It's not just sitting there waiting for me to speed test. I mean, apparently it's got more down than it does up, which is fascinating. But poor urban fiber's like, what are you guys doing to me right now? So now what? How do we test this thing? What even do, Danny?
Multiple sources.
I mean, you know what?
Or find a CDN or a torrent or
something. Oh, a torrent. A torrent could work. Well, I wouldn't know anything about torrenting, Danny. You know what? I'm gonna call 2.5 gig up okay for now, and I'm just gonna do like a fun test, okay? Because technically, Google is in Harbor Center, right? So why don't we upload something? So slight correction, Google is peered there. But either way, we should be looking at some pretty serious speeds here. 2.6 gigs. Let's upload it to YouTube. Weak, weak YouTube. You're weak. All right, we're gonna have to find something else. Like what can we like hit with this? iPerf test? Yeah, I need that running on the thing remotely. So basically there's nothing that we can do to test this other than hand this connection over to the float plane guys and give them a server here in our server room and then do like a live stream or something. So maybe that's something that we'll do in the near future and see how hard we can hit this thing. In the meantime though, massive thanks to Danny and the ITEL folks, Chad coming out here and helping us hook this up. Massive thanks for the discount, I guess. It wasn't that substantial, it's still very expensive, but they claim they're not making any money on it. So, you know, it's the word of an ISP. So they're pretty nice guys, but yeah, I don't know. And a massive shout out to our sponsor for today's video, Audible. Audible can help you out with their exclusive Audible Originals that feature exclusive audio titles created by celebrated storytellers from worlds as diverse as theater, journalism, literature, and more. And the coolest thing is you can get your first audiobook for free just by going to audible.com/Linus and trying out Audible for 30 days. You can also text Linus to 500-500. One book that we suggest that's only available on Audible is Cracking the Tech Career. It provides a bunch of great advice about career paths that are available in the tech industry and how to make your application the most attractive one in the pile. So again, that's audible.com/Linus or text Linus to 500-500. So thanks for watching, guys. If you disliked this video, you can hit that button. If you liked it, hit like, get subscribed, or maybe consider checking out where to buy the stuff we featured at the link in the video description. I'm actually serious about that. ITEL has been absolutely fantastic to us. I just love giving them a hard time. They're only really business. You guys don't do any consumer at this point, do you? So there you go. But at any rate, they've been really good to us. And also while you're down there, you can check out our merch store, which has cool shirts like this one, and our community forum, which is definitely worth a join. So we could actually host the forum out of here now. There would be no reason not to do that anymore. Fascinating. We'd probably have to get a better UPS. Maybe like a generator backup. Okay, not yet. Later.